Hi guys, welcome back to my channel. Today I'm going to be doing a watercolor painting tutorial, which I haven't done in a while, so I'm excited about it. I'm painting this fox in a semi-realistic style, and I wanted to show you guys how I achieve this look and style with watercolor, because this is kind of the only look I really know how to do in watercolor, but I'm kind of happy with it, and I don't paint with watercolor super often anymore, so I was really excited to do something a little bit like refreshing on my channel. But anyway, I want to go through a couple of basic techniques before I begin for anyone who's maybe new to watercolor. I'm starting off with the wet on wet technique. So paint a layer of water onto your paper, but don't soak your paper with water. Then go ahead and drop the paint directly onto the paper, and it'll just blend itself out, and you can get a really cool background effect this way. Also, the colors will blend so much more easily this way. So I really do like using this method for backgrounds, but you don't have a ton of control with this method. The second one is the wet on dry technique. So notice I didn't add any water beforehand to the paper, but I did mix my paint with a good amount of water. And then when I go in, I can just drop more colors down into whatever original color of paint that I had put onto the paper. And you can see I'm using my brush to blend those colors out, but it's not going to have the same blended effect as the wet on wet technique. You do have more control with this method though. The last method is dry on dry. You have the most control with this method. And I don't use completely dry paint for this. I do mix a little bit of water into it, but not very much. And you can get intense colors and kind of more like details, and you can just have a lot more control. So this is great if you are in the end stages of your painting and you want to define things a little bit. And then lastly, I'm going to show you how I decorate my painting afterwards. So after I'm finished actually working on everything, I like to splatter some paint, and a lot of people do this. So I tap my brushes together, and one brush is loaded with paint and water, and I get a splatter effect. And then I did drop some water down just to show you the different effects you can get. But this is really great if you want to add a little bit of, like, I don't know, like spice or something to your painting when it's finished. And I really enjoy doing the paint splatter effect. It is super fun. Obviously, these are just a couple of techniques in watercolor, and they're pretty basic techniques, but it's always helpful to practice these before you do a watercolor painting, just so you know how much water you need to add to get a different result. I'm using this pan watercolor set. It's the Cotman set, but you can use any watercolor set that you have and it will be fine. I just prefer using the pan one because it's easier for me to mix colors and stuff like that. But anyways, I use a kneaded eraser to remove my graphite before I start painting. I really love to start with the eye when I'm working on an animal or a person, so I'm starting with the eyes in this painting using a wet on dry technique. So with all the detailed areas, to start out, I'm using a wet on dry technique. I want to have the most control in detailed areas, so I'm using a small pointy round brush for this because that works really well. And I am just being really careful not to let the paint flow too freely. The more water you add, the more that the paint will flow and you'll have less control over it, which isn't good when you're working in a detailed area. When I go to work on the nose, what I did was I added some blue color to the bottom where the shadow is going to be later, and then I added some clear water on top just a little bit, and I kind of just let that paint flow a little, and it created not a complete perfect gradient, but it helped create more of a smooth blend from the shadow to the highlight. You have to be really careful with watercolor and highlights because you need to preserve them. You can't add them at the end like you would with another medium like acrylic. With the mouth, I kind of just create small little fur strokes, and I'm adding a little bit of blue paint. So there is a lot of blue paint going on, and that's because the blue shadow in my reference photo is really prominent, and I thought that the blue would be such a cool contrast against the orange colors of the fox's coat anyway, so I was really excited to see how those colors would look together. But you'll notice that my first layer here, when it dries, you can see it dry, it kind of just looks a little bit more muted and faded. And that's kind of how watercolor is it dries looking more faded than when it was wet. And that's totally okay because you can build up your layers. And even if you have to do multiple layers, you'll eventually get the result that you want. So it's almost better to start out with a light layer in case there's something you don't like, and just so that you don't have any incidents with having way too dark of paint on your paper early on in your painting. So when I'm painting around the eyes, I'm using some indigo blue color and a little bit of purple even. So there's a lot of colors going on, and I think that the more colors you add to your watercolor painting, the better. And as long as those colors look nice together and don't create a muddy color when you mix them, I think it's totally fine to add a lot of extra drops of color just to make your painting more interesting. Like right now I'm adding some brighter blue color to the nose, like snout area, and I think it really helps make the painting pop, and it just is really fun to add drops of brighter colors and even a little bit of purple, as you can see. And I'm very strategic about the way that I'm painting, so I want to make sure I'm painting in the correct direction of where the fur of the animal is growing, and that way you still get that realistic look even if you don't paint in every single fur stroke, which obviously you can see that even though some of the strokes I'm doing look a little bit like fur, most of them I'm just dropping color down and letting it blend together. So even if you do that, you can still create a sort of semi-realistic result just by adding some fur strokes in some areas. I do go in and add some green underneath his snout area as a shadow that I saw in the reference photo. So even if you see like weird colors going on in your reference photo, you never know, it might look kind of cool. You just have to be careful, make sure that your paint does not blend together in a way that looks super, super muddy. Because at the beginning here, it looked a little bit muddy and I kind of work on that later. But I was getting a very loose effect in this area of the painting. So now you see that I've moved on from the detailed areas of the face and I'm now doing like wider brush strokes to create more wider fur strokes, I guess. And I'm being a little bit more messy with this area and using slightly more of like a wet on wet technique almost here. You can see me dropping in paint, but I'm also careful to paint the fur in the correct directions. So near the mouth, it's going kind of like to the side and then it slowly starts going down. And I think that small little details like that can really make or break your painting, especially if you still want to have elements of realism going on. I think this is a very like Arctic looking fox at this point, especially because right now I only have the blue paint down and I haven't started on the orange part of the coat. But anyway, I really think the blue colors look really cool together. I'm being really, really loose at the bottom area and I'm just dropping in like little bits of color and being a little bit more expressive with it. And then I go in and add another layer to that shadowed area underneath the snout and also the nose. So once an area dries, you can go back in and use the same method you did before. So like the wet on dry technique that I was using before, but now I'm dropping in darker colors, like darker indigo blue color, maybe even a bit of black. And I am just letting that sort of blend together a little bit with the surrounding colors. So I do drop a brighter blue because the tones are so muted at this point. I'm gonna add some hints of brighter blue and purple just to give the painting a little bit more color. With watercolor, if you are new to it, you can easily become frustrated at how many layers you kind of have to add to get a brighter end result. And it's kind of honestly annoying at first because your paint will dry so much more or less bright. And then I go in, I work on the eyes a little bit more, I'm adding some more shadow, but I'm still not going in and adding my like black really dark paint yet because I just want to build that up. When you use black paint right away, you kind of risk accidentally smudging it into the surrounding wet areas on your paper, and you might accidentally use too much paint and so much can go wrong. So I prefer to just build up to that. And I think I used more of an indigo blue color. I went in and started working on the inside of the ears because the colors there were similar to the colors I was already working in. So I figured I could start adding some layers before I start working on the orange coat of the fox because that's a totally different color set. And you can see me still painting fur strokes and then letting some areas blend together. So in some areas it doesn't look like there's any fur strokes, and then more towards the outside there are. And I think that that looks really cool in this type of painting. And now I started to blend together some orange tones so that I can start working on the coat, the fur coat of the fox. And at this point, I think most of the areas I've worked in before on the snout are completely dry. And that's kind of important. You don't want your paint to blend together in areas it's not supposed to blend together. And so be patient, or even just use a hairdryer if you're not patient. Like me, I'm not very patient, so I sometimes do that. But anyway, so I'm adding some red tones in, and these are very like burnt orange burnt red colors. So it took me a little bit of time to mix some of those together, but I did want it to be colorful. I wanted there to be some brighter orange and then some more like rusty red color. And I just wanted the entire painting to include a lot of colors. As I go to tackle more of the right side of the painting, I'm very, very loose with this area. So I'm gonna start using more of a wet on wet technique and also a little bit of a wet on dry technique, but with a little bit of a first stroke look. So I'm still gonna paint in the correct direction that I'm supposed to be painting, but I might be a little bit messier with it. And at some point, I think I accidentally put a little bit too much water because I ended up getting a cauliflower effect. And to avoid that, you kind of have to let your layer dry and not be too impatient before you go and add another layer. But as I said before, sometimes I can be impatient and I end up getting that effect when I didn't really mean to. But since this is such an interestingly like textured painting, it turned out okay in the end. And then I went in and did some fur strokes at the top area, which really helped create that fur illusion like I have mentioned before. And then I'm just dropping in some more orange and red tones. And I think that I just let this layer dry for a little while. And it wasn't very smart of me to work on the right side and then go in and work on the left side some, but I'm careful not to touch the wet paint to my hand and mess up my painting. At this point, I think that the fox is really starting to look more like together and the piece is looking a lot better, and I start going in and adding some much brighter tones and dark areas around the eyes. So what you want to do is the areas that you want to stand out the most are where you want to of course put the most color, maybe some darker areas, more contrast and things like that. And I really want the fox's face to stand out the most in this entire painting. So there is a lot more work that I'm doing around the eye area and the snout area than compared to like the right side of the painting. So the fur, I kind of am loose with it and just have fun with it. And I do drop some different colors down and things like that. But I am much more careful around the face area so that that area will stand out the most in my end result. And then I did add some violet color even to some areas, and I just wanted to be super colorful with it. And I did see some violet going on in my reference photo because, as I said, it was a very colorful reference photo. So if you see weird colors going on in your reference photo, it might be perfect to add those colors to your painting, and it'll help make things pop and make things a little bit more interesting. But I think the biggest thing is you have to be careful, make sure areas dry before you go in and add more paint, because you can end up lifting previous paint off of your paper accidentally, or you could just end up with a big mess. Like, so many things can go wrong if you don't let your areas dry before you go ahead and add more paint to it. But I do go in and start adding some black, very, very more like dark, intense colors to the nose and the mouth. And you can really see why you don't want to do this to start out with, because you would just have like a really, really dark area that you might not know what to do with. And it might not have any undertones and things like that if you just started out directly with the dark black paint. So I'm adding that dark paint to the ears as well. Look for the areas that have the most contrast and definitely make sure to try and live up to that and add the contrast, because it is a struggle with watercolor paint to get contrast. You just have to be patient and work in multiple layers to get there. This part was really scary, adding the contrast around the eyes, adding that dark paint. So you have to make sure everything's completely dry, as I said before. And I am using very, very little water at this stage because I want to have the most control possible. So I'm using more of a dry on dry technique, but I'm still mixing a little bit of water into my paint. I'm just being a lot more careful. And I'm even using some indigo blue to help the black paint blend in a little bit better with the surrounding areas so that it doesn't look too harsh. Once you add your high contrast areas, you'll know where you need to continue to build up contrast in other areas. So I'm going in and darkening up some areas and adding some more color, including more orange and red around the eyes. And I really wanted that to be an intense area. And I still wanted to do a few like fur strokes and to make things look a little bit more realistic as well, because some areas don't have many fur strokes at all. So I went in and started to work on that using less water than my previous layers. So you kind of have to use a little bit less water as you add more and more layers, especially for a detailed area. One problem I find myself having with watercolor paint is accidentally overdoing a painting or an area. And I just really struggle with this because I always want to get the most detail and contrast possible, and sometimes I just kind of overdo things. So you kind of also have to know where to stop, and you don't want to overdo your painting to the point of it looking too messy. I did go in and add some more black to the ear area and just darkened up some of those areas that are supposed to be really dark. And I'm just trying to be careful around the edges. You want to be careful around the edges of your painting and make sure that things look nice and crisp and not super messy, and you can be more messy towards the inside of your painting and a little bit more like have a little bit more of like an expressionist style, I guess. But anyway, so I did add the pupil of the eye in, and I just wanted to mention that I was really careful. I used a dry on dry technique. I was super, super careful to keep that shape, and you really want to make sure that the rest of the eye is dry first so that the paint does not just like flow out everywhere, because that can happen and create a total mess. So I was really careful about that. And then I went in and started adding some more areas where the whiskers are going to be, and you can see how the contrast really helps to make this piece stand out, because I am adding more and more color to certain areas and then leaving some areas almost completely white or super light. And I think that that's really important too when you're painting with watercolor. By the way, I feel like I'm talking really fast in this video, and I'm just trying to pack in as much information as I can. I had coffee before this and everything. I'm just trying to make sure that I get in everything that I meant to talk about, so sorry if I'm talking super, super fast. Also, you can totally use a little bit bigger of a round brush for some of these areas. I don't know why I kind of didn't really switch up my brushes too much. I think I just used this brush and also maybe a slightly bigger round brush, but for the most part, I was sticking with a smaller brush, and that works great for the detailed areas, but for some areas, I could have used a slightly bigger brush. But you do have to be careful. Make sure for your detailed areas, you're using an appropriately sized brush so that you don't create a mess out of everything. I feel like this fox looks so sneaky and like deceiving too. I totally love it. And to finish off this painting, I did the splatter effect and decorated it a little bit. And I didn't want to do a background because I wanted the fox to stand out a lot. You have to be careful with backgrounds sometimes. Instead, I wanted to just do the splatter effect and make him stand out a little bit more against the white paper. Then I went in and did the whiskers. And here's a tip, guys. So if you're using cold pressed paper, it's really hard to get little fine lines like this. And I was using cold pressed watercolor paper. Hot pressed is much better for this. But I was going in and trying to create those whiskers, and I was being so careful, and I still didn't get the perfect whiskers like how I wanted to. You have to add just a little bit of water, not a lot of water, or else you can't get that fine line. But with the cold press paper, the paintbrush kind of drags when you're trying to get such a fine line like that, so you have to be even more strategic with it. But I think that the end result came out pretty good. Also, I have to mention, a lot of people like to use fine liners and other things at the end and do like a mixed media watercolor painting, and I've done that before, but I'm not entirely good at it. So I decided not to add any extra things to this. The only thing I'm gonna add is some highlight in the eye with a white gel pen, which I absolutely love to do this no matter what medium I'm working in. If I can use a white gel pen to add an eye highlight, I just love to do that and create that life and like gleam in the eye of the animal or person I'm drawing. And that's it for this video, guys. So this is how my watercolor fox turned out. Anyway, thank you so much for watching this video, and leave a comment. Let me know what you thought of this painting or the tutorial or anything related to watercolor, really. I'd love to do some more watercolor tutorials in the future as well. But that's it for now. Thank you so much for watching again, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye, guys.